CNN's chief medical correspondent, chief medical reporter, a neurosurgeon, and also we'll be talking about letting you know where you can get up-to-the-minute information, not only from him on television, but on his podcast. He is Dr. Sanjay Gupta here on The Rich Eisen Show. How are you, Dr. Gupta?
I'm doing well, Rich. Thanks for having me. Busy days, as you know.
I know that, and so I truly appreciate you giving us some time right here. I will just open the floor to you and say, what do you think people should know first and most about what is going on in this world, Dr. Gupta?
Well, you know, we as people have sort of heard over the last couple of months, you know, this new virus started spreading around the world. It's important to call it a new virus because it hadn't affected humans before, and there's a lot that we're still learning about it. I think most people who are exposed to this virus, which I do think is going to be most of the world, like the flu virus, are going to recover from this and not have, you know, significant problems. There are certain people who are being called vulnerable to this virus, people in their 70s and 80s, and people with four particular pre-existing conditions, which are heart disease, lung disease, diabetes, and hypertension. They're more at risk. And I think what I would like people to know is, you know, that when we talk about a virus, it's something that can spread from person to person, and we can actually do a lot to try and decrease that spread. And right now, probably more than I think I can remember in 20 years of doing this, Rich, we are very dependent on each other. How you behave will influence my health, and how I behave will influence your health. And so, you know, if we're practicing healthy behaviors, many of which people have now heard countless times, I'm happy to talk about those as well. But if we practice healthy behaviors, you should think about it that you're doing it not just for yourself, but for the people around you, the people you love, and, you know, sort of the global community. We've gotten through pandemics before. We're going to get through this pandemic. We've seen really optimistic signs, not just in China. Everyone points to China, and the numbers in China have started to go way down, which is great. But also in places like Singapore and Hong Kong, you know, where they've done a really good job. So, you know, there's been some missteps here, and, you know, I'm sort of adopting the Fauci sort of stance on this, where right now I don't really have time to rehash the missteps because we have to have the pedal to the metal and everything's got to be moving forward. So I'd like to talk about the future, not the past. And there's things that we can do now going forward that I think can make a significant difference. Some of it's societal and some of it's individual. And I think, you know, if we do those things, I think we're gonna really get through this.
Let's unpack that one step at a time. Again, Dr. Sanjay Gupta, CNN's chief medical correspondent, and he's got a new podcast out, Coronavirus Facts Versus Fiction, that I suggest everybody check out right here on The Rich Eisen Show. Testing. Yeah. Let's talk about that, because so many sports fans are hearing that Charles Barkley got a test. The entire Utah Jazz organization got a test. Where are we on testing, Dr. Gupta? What can you tell us about testing to potentially give everybody an idea where that's headed? You talk about the future.
You know, you think about the public sector and the private sector. The public sector typically takes charge, at least the initial charge, in situations like this, and for lots of different reasons, that fell short. Private sector is now really coming online, and ultimately, no matter what, in these situations, the private sector ends up being the big part of the scale up when it comes to these testing. And I'm talking about organizations like LabCorp and Quest. Mm-hmm. They have the facilities, they have the resources, and, you know, the space, all of that, to be able to really scale up. So they're coming online now. I think within the next several days, you know, by mid next week. Everyone kept saying, you know, 2 weeks ago we were going to be there. We weren't. But I think by mid next week, the end of next week, we're going to have gone from, you know, performing now, you know, not even maybe 100 tests a day to thousands of tests a day. And as Dr. Fauci has said, you know, ultimately we're going to need millions and millions of tests because there's going to be that many people who do need to get tested because they're concerned, but also to try and get a better idea of just what this is looking like, how widespread this is. We don't have eyes on this, mm-hmm. as Dr. Redfield said. He uses these hunting metaphors, but we don't have eyes on this right now, and we need that to best dictate some of the strategies going forward. You're hearing about a lot of strategies, and the reason I think some of them seem a little scattershock right now is because we don't really know exactly where this virus is spreading most robustly. We need to know that.
Well, we had a fan of the show call in before and wanted me to ask you in regards to social distancing, which you pointed out, we're all practicing hygiene, that my hygiene practices affects you and vice versa, Dr.
Yeah.
Gupta. How can we all get on the same page? I'm seeing all these, we're all seeing all these sporting events get canceled, and then
yeah.
I saw a Post Malone concert in Denver have tens of, a couple, 20,000 people in Denver last night. How do we all get on the same page that way?
Well, you know, I mean, I think, you know, look, unlike China, this is not an autocratic country. You know, in China, they basically said, you know, we're going to shut down very large areas of the country, or very large populations, I should say, 60 million people, you know, in the Hubei province. You know, that's just not something that we're likely to see in America. But having said that, you know, the president today is going to likely be declaring a national emergency. There hasn't been these triggers, I think, Rich, to say, okay, now at this point, here's the point at which you shut down schools. Here's the point where you prevent mass gatherings. Here's the point where large corporations have to say their employees all work from home. It's been sort of ad hoc. You know, Governor Cuomo declared a containment area. You know, go back to President Trump when the patients, passengers came out of China and there was 195 people in quarantine. It was a significant move. You know, we hadn't had quarantines in this country in 60 years since smallpox. You know, people may not realize that. Some of what's happening right now are things that haven't happened in a very, very long time. Some of them have never happened before. So I think, to answer your question, I think as part of the national emergency, there may be a greater uniformity, if you will, to some of these things. You know, I mean, concerts, you know, it may come down that there's a proclamation that there cannot be mass gatherings anymore of a certain size. And I'm happy to explain that, why that, what the rationale on that is.
Please.
But, well, you know, in part it is obviously health, right? You know, you get a virus, if you get a bunch of people who are together that can't distance themselves at least 3 to 6 feet, that virus is likely to spread. So what all these things are fundamentally about is trying to break the cycle of transmission. If you can break the cycle of transmission, the virus can't go from host to host. Right now we are the hosts, humans. And so if you can break that cycle of transmission, with time, the virus starts to peter out and, you know, can't find hosts. And that's how we've helped address pandemics in the past, including SARS, which is another coronavirus. So that's part of the goal. But there's another part to it as well, and I think this might actually be more relevant to people.
Sure.
And that is that if somebody, let's say you're at one of these mass gatherings or concert or whatever it might be, and somebody subsequently in a day or two tests positive, what's going to happen? The public health department at that point is going to want to do what's called contact tracing and figure out who are all the people this person who's tested positive may come in contact with. And they're going to go find those people and likely tell those people they now have to quarantine themselves for 14 days. So it's obviously medical concern is the primary concern. But the idea of the social disruption around this, not to mention the amount of efforts it takes by the public health community to then go find all those people, it's a significant effort to do that, is significant as well. It's something that in the middle of a pandemic like this, you'd rather not have your public health people trying to find all the people who attended a particular concert and sat in such and such section because they may be potentially infected. And by the way, they may not all live in that city. People may have come from other cities. People may have come from other states. They're going back to their home states. Who were they in contact with over there? You can see how what an effort it is. A mass gathering like that in the midst of a pandemic is both a medical and social sort of concern.
A couple more minutes left with Dr. Sanjay Gupta, CNN chief medical correspondent here on the Rich Eisen Show. So many people listening to us and watching us right now, Dr. Gupta,
yeah.
are potentially in smaller communities in the United States of America that are grappling with the issue of, do we let the kids' leagues finish up their leagues? Do we let seniors go through their entire high school season preparing for baseball, preparing for spring sports, and now we just cancel them? But you know what? Nobody's sick in this town. Let's go ahead and do it. What do you suggest to those people right now, Dr. Gupta?
Well, this is moving so fast. I don't think I've covered a story ever that's moving this fast. So, I mean, literally, you know, within the next hour, by 3 o'clock, you know, right after the president's speech, I think we're going to have a better idea. First of all, if those are even decisions that we can make, because you know, it may come down as part of a national emergency, from the national emergency to all these school districts in terms of what they have to do, and then you know, some of these questions are going to be answered. I do want to say one thing about the school closings in particular and athletics, though, and that is that this is not the flu. And what I mean by that is that, you know, when you look at the benefit of school closings in the past, much of the benefit of that was based on models of the flu. Kids get the flu. They can spread the flu, and they spread the flu a lot, little kids do in particular, but also, you know, older kids do. With this infection, and we don't really know why, kids aren't really getting sick from this, and they're not, you know, really getting infected from this. While they can spread it, it's not likely. So they could be carrying the virus in their bodies without any symptoms. They could still spread it, but it's not likely. So I'm not sure the rationale for school closings ultimately will be thought to be that beneficial. Hmm. I think we're still grappling through this, and I think that's going to affect everything. All the other questions you're asking about, you know, obviously sports leagues, all the extracurricular activities, all of that. Look, we're going through this. I just got the phone with my wife. We're going through this as well. Kids get pulled out of school. My wife's now figuring out about her work. And
right.
That's another, I mean, you know, a lot of the healthcare staff in the country, they have kids. So you're going to start pulling healthcare workers out of the clinics and hospitals at a time when you really need them because of these school closings. You really got to look at the ripple effect and figure out if it's worth it. Everything in life is a risk-reward relationship, and that's true here as well. We know what the cost in so many ways of mass school closings are. We tried this during H1N1. There were 700 schools closed around the country, 50 in New York City alone. And in retrospect, you know, even though that was a flu virus, it wasn't even clear what the benefit was exactly. Given that this doesn't really affect kids as much, I think that question is going to really need to be addressed in the days to come. Not weeks, but days to come.
Yeah, that's what I want to just finish up with you. Last one for you. I'm going to combine two and for you, and then you can answer how you wish with Dr. Sanjay Gupta. So many fans hearing, again, Masters postponed. This season for the NBA is suspended. How long do you think this will last, should last? And you mentioned earlier prevention. What would you suggest to people to do on a daily basis to try and help in the prevention of the spread of this virus, Dr. Gupta?
Sure. Yeah, well, with regard to the first question, like, you know, is there light at the end of the tunnel here, right? And I think everyone's asking that question, or is this the new normal? I don't think it's a new normal. And, you know, I want to be humble here because it's a new virus, and so no one knows for sure. And anyone who tells you they know for sure, you know, they can't, because we just don't. But previous coronaviruses have had what's called a seasonality. So, you know, they're more robust in certain seasons versus others, and the season where they tend to be circulating more is colder weather. SARS, you know, the peak was sort of late March, early April. I keep bringing up SARS because that was also a coronavirus, so a similar virus. And I think that there's a likelihood of that happening here. This is behaving in some ways like flu, and flu does the same thing. It has a seasonality to it. That does mean that, you know, as the warmer weather comes, the numbers go down. As the weather gets cooler, the virus is likely to start, you know, reemerging in bigger numbers. But keep in mind, as this virus is circulating right now, people who are exposed to it may develop some immunity. So if it does come back next season, we may have a certain number of people in the country who are more protected from it, and that provides what's called a herd immunity. So even for people who didn't get exposed, they get buffered, if you will, by the people who were protected from the previous season. You know, with regard to protection, and sometimes it feels silly talking about these basic measures in the middle of a pandemic.
Yes.
But you know, this is respiratory illness. So for the most part, through coughs and sneezes, respiratory droplets are released into the air. They travel, you know, typically no more than 6 feet. You know, they can travel further, but that's, you know, sort of the average. And they can stay in the air for a little bit and transmit that way, or they fall to ground or to surfaces. So if you think about that, you just imagine now those viral particles inside the respiratory droplets and how they would transmit from a person who's infected to someone else. You get a pretty clear idea of how to protect yourself. If you're sick, don't go out. If you see someone who's sick, don't go by them. We talk about washing hands because we're constantly touching things, even without thinking about it. I could tell you don't touch things. That's not practical. But if you wash your hands well and you disinfect surfaces, you're a lot less likely to get, you know, to have the virus transmitted to you by yourself, by touching your eyes, your nose, or your mouth. Those basic things really apply. And then I think, you know, again, I've been talking to my parents every day. Mm-hmm. You know, they're in their late 70s. They live in Florida. And, you know, they're hearing all the news coverage. 80% of people are going to be fine. And, you know, what are they thinking? What about us, right? So we are potentially the healthy people, people who don't have any symptoms. We could still put the vulnerable people at risk. So if I visit my parents, I want to make sure that I'm consider myself as potentially someone who could transmit the virus to them. So all the basic hygienic principles that I told you about, I would absolutely be just 100% diligent about it. It's not a side thought. It's a forethought, always, you know, right now. It should be. And so I think the idea that we can all do a lot to sort of create a wall of protection around the vulnerable is really important for the next, you know, the next several weeks. We should always do that, but for the next several weeks in particular. So again, you know, how I behave greatly affects their health. And so we all have to take that very seriously.
Dr. Gupta, really appreciate the time. Really enjoy your work and go blue.
Thanks. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm going to miss that this season, but, you know, I think it's the right call.
No, it is the right call, right? The number of people that I hear like, hey, this is an overreaction. This is the right call in order to do what you say needs to be done to flatten the curve and make sure the healthcare system is not overwhelmed, correct?
Exactly. That's exactly right.
Okay. I will be one of the many listening to your podcast, Coronavirus Facts versus Fiction. Thanks for the call, Dr. Sanjay Gupta.
Anytime, Rich. Thanks for having me.
I'll be reaching out again. You bet. That's Dr. Sanjay Gupta, Chief Medical Correspondent of CNN.